You see, a lot of times we can bring people to knowledge, but we cannot teach. Minister Sayed-Khaiyum here, because, of course, you know, you had the budget period.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, the Vice-Chancellor, the staff, the members of the University Council, and of course, the students. We have to apologize. I have to apologize to you, firstly, because I'm the first time using a device to read a speech. I've never done this before. So I also would like to, of course, acknowledge the invitation by the Vice-Chancellor. He was very persistent, and seeing that I was here in the West, I thought I'd actually do the honors and indeed have the privilege of coming and speaking to you. I have one confession to make, of course, and my confession is that I have, unfortunately, due to a number of commitments, been unable to give the right quality and time actually put a proper lecture together for you. In fact, I just thought about some ideas last night, put some words together at the airport literally this morning when I landed at Nandi Airport. I apologize both to myself and also to you for that. However, I have put something together. Of course, coming to university, and then you feel the pressure that if you say something very profound, these are very smart people, university, and you have to say something profound. But of course, ladies and gentlemen, profundity is something, many would argue, that is something very subjective. Depends on who is listening to it, depending on whose mind is actually being processed to be able to listen to what I'm actually saying. Of course, what we hear, what we think, and more importantly, what we are taught to think, what we are taught to hear, and what we should process in our minds as a norm is again subject to our conditioning. What you're actually going to hear from me, if I say something that you're not used to hearing, you may actually not like it. If I say something that your mind has not processed before, you may not be able to necessarily process it. Of course, anything that people do say that is outside your way of thinking, outside of your way of hearing, you can either reject it, you can shut it out, it may cause you uncomfortableness, you may actually see it as a threat, you may actually get angry, and then you may get frustrated. Some people may react physically. Now, I may say something that you may already hear. If I say something about it, you can react very harshly against it. And of course, we see that happening throughout the day, it happens throughout the world, and we happen to see happening in other countries. Universities, of course, ladies and gentlemen, are supposed to be places and environments where, or indeed, many will argue, are sanctuaries, where we supposedly, you supposedly can come here and listen to anything, be able to process anything, have an open mind, be neutral about it. That's what supposedly universities are for. That is why throughout history, many universities, in particular the pre-colonial societies, post-colonial societies, and industrial societies, universities have always been the genesis of where revolutions have taken place, where social movements have emanated from, where uprisings against colonialism have taken place, where new ideas have come from, and they generally have all come from universities. Even if you look at the French uprising in reaction to the economic policies they had indeed came from universities. Of course, they would argue that universities have become a bit more sedate nowadays. Universities are now seen perhaps more to be an environment where new innovations and technologies take place. Actually, they get patented and they get commercial use out of it. There seems to be a lot of drive in university towards that. Of course, it does not mean that frontiers for socioeconomic and political ideas, and indeed that they're creating new frontiers. So this, using this as the background, ladies and gentlemen, I hope that you've understood what I'm saying to you, that I hope that you actually have an open mind. I hope that you listen to some of these ideas with a new way of looking at things. But the reason I'm not saying this to you is that I think in Fiji at the moment we have a situation. And the situation is that our ability to think outside the box is being stalled, is being stifled by some people. It's being stalled and stifled not just by people, but indeed by organizations, by certain sections of the media, or even all sections of the media, depending on how they view news. What is news? Do you realize that when you pick up the newspaper, when you watch the television, it is somebody sitting there and deciding for you what is going to be the news that you are going to read? You have to understand that. The front page of the newspaper is determined by the editor or the people sitting in the editing room of the newspaper. The first news that you watch on television is actually determined by the news director in the newsroom. Anybody who knows a little bit about media, for example, regarding television, will tell you that most people, and I'm sure you realize this, if you watch the television news, you will generally pay more attention to the news until the first ad break. After the first ad break, you kind of lose attention. This is why those people who advertise commercially in TV stations, in the news, the first ad break is the one that you pay the highest fee. The ad is going to come after the sports, or between the sports, is going to be a lesser cost than the ad break that you're going to advertise in the first ad break. So you have to be able to understand what you actually read. What you see is actually determined by other people also. And for you, what is really important is for you to become a lot more discerning, for you to be able to understand what is manufactured for you, what process is manufactured for you. Of course, most of the students here are what we call the millennials. You are all millennials, the X generation. You are the people who are the newest generation on the planet Earth. We have particular unique qualities, as has been highlighted. Let me tell you what it says about millennials. Millennials are known as Generation X. Of course, your ability to be the same as other millennials throughout the world may vary. The millennials in, for example, downtown New York may be the same age as you, maybe slightly different from you. The way they think, the environment is different. But there's one thing that's in common. All of you have now access to technology, and have access to technology like you never had before. In my days, we did not even have television. I'm 53 years old, and I was in high school, there was no television. We did not even know what a mobile phone was. Today, there are more SIM cards in Fiji than the actual number of people. I know some of you carry two SIM cards. Some of you for legitimate reasons, others for illegitimate reasons. There are now 500,000 smartphones in Fiji. Can you please put up your hand if you have a Facebook account? So the people who are putting up their hand actually don't have a Facebook account. The rest of you obviously have a Facebook account. We have over figures that say we have over 500,000 Facebook card holders in Fiji. You now have access to information, and the speed with which you have access to information is unprecedented. When I was a young man, and you know, I was a big fan of Muhammad Ali, the boxer, whenever his fights used to come on, a week later, we used to go and see his fights. I remember living in Suwa and Century Theater. This is Shogi. I went and saw the Muhammad Ali close form fight with my father. And we thought it was unbelievable that 1 week after their fighting in Africa, we were able to see the fight in Fiji. Today, you guys don't see it like you want to see it. how much technology has changed, and indeed that's how much our minds have changed. Of course, some people in a negative perspective view the millennial generation as very individualistic, as very selfish. That's why you're servants. Today, there is a new way of thinking. Our access to selfies means that a lot more people spend a lot more time admiring themselves. A lot more people spend more time taking photographs of themselves. It's a fact. Asking people around you, a bit older than you, when in their days you still take your own camera photographs. So does that mean we have become inward looking? Does that mean that just because we have access to this technology, our minds are a lot more freer? Many people would argue, at least from the Fijian perspective, that if you read what is actually happening on social media, we have actually gone in the way backwards. We have one person posting one post, and you have 500 commenting on it, without knowing the facts. Absolutely not knowing the facts at all. And of course, many people will try and use that to their own advantage. Are we becoming more critical? Or are we simply accepting the fact that what is posted on social media is something that you take as a fact? I can put this young man in Photoshop here and put him in front of a brothel. Can you do that? And I posted it. So it was in Niraj. Niraj seeing in front of a brothel. How many of you would actually comment on that? I have seen comments, people saying, my God, this is terrible. I knew his father when he used to go to church. I knew his sister. I visited his home. I did not know he would turn out to be like that. People do it. Of course, on the flip side, many people are using social media to spread false information, false news. You see, fake news. I have died 3 times. Unfortunately, social media also killed one of our former presidents very much alive. We have seen people spread hatred through social media. Ethnicity, racism has become prominent. Recently there was some comment going on about one of the ministries. I actually don't have a Facebook account. People actually do send me screenshots sometimes. I tell generally people not to. Because I think it's a huge distraction in your day-to-day work. Because if you were to react to everything on social media, you won't get any work done. For me personally, that's how I feel. Or, subconsciously, if you read it all the time, it can affect the decisions you make. Because you need to be able to make the decisions in an objective environment. That is very critical. So, we've had actually people commenting on this particular ministry's work, and I saw how quickly it took an ethnic turn. I saw how quickly it was generalized. And that is very unfortunate. So that's one of the key issues I just wanted to highlight to you today. As a millennial, what are you doing with that availability of technology? With that availability of access to information, are you putting it to good use? You can argue and say, well, what do you mean by use? What's good use? What's the definition of good use? Can be very subjective, of course. But I believe there are certain objective tests that you can meet. One of them, of course, is if you have access to information, are you using that information to empower yourself? Are you using the information to empower other people? I know many of you in this university may come from farming backgrounds because of the fact that you're located in this part of the city. Are you sharing the information with your grandparents? Are you actually going to Wikipedia or any other search engines or any other site that makes you increase their knowledge? Are you using that information to tell them about climate change? Or are you using social media simply to take a photograph of yourself and say, now I am boarding the bus? Sorry, oops, I got a little break, I'm going to go to the loop. I've seen people do that. So is there any redundancy? I'm not saying you cannot have fun and games. Of course you can. Of course, many countries now, when you go for a job interview, the employers actually go through social media to see how you behave on social media. I'm not sure whether private companies in Fiji are doing that. Some of them may start doing it. Of course, it becomes actually a catch. There are some people who are not on social media, but their pictures are on social media. And the pictures that they took maybe 30 years ago are on social media. I've seen photographs of people who are older than me, whose photographs that they took when they were in high school or then primary school with their friends. Some people who, you know, used to drink, for example, when they were 17 years old or 18 years old, they have not had a drink for 30 years. The photograph of them with a beer bottle in front of them is now on social media. Do we realize that the people who are putting up those photographs, perhaps without their knowledge, what kind of impact do we have on their lives, on their spouses, on their children? These things are very important issues for us to be able to consider. So the issue about using social media in a responsible manner and in that form of empowerment, I think, is very critical. Technology, access to technology, access to information must give us the ability to empower ourselves. It must actually give you the ability to find the truth. You must have the ability to find the truth. Ladies and gentlemen, I think the other point that I wanted to, without laboring too much, that I wanted to also make, and I, as I said to the VC, I'm quite happy to take questions after this. You know, just finishing off that issue of social media, in Germany, the German government, just this year, approved a new bill that punishes social network sites if they fail to swiftly remove illegal content such as hate speech or defamatory fake news. Chancellor Merkel's government agreed on rules that will impose fines of up to 50 million euros on Facebook, Twitter, and other social media platforms. So the burden of proof actually has been given to those platforms, to Facebook, to Twitter, that if they do not, within a specified period of time, remove those comments, then they are liable for those types of penalties. So they themselves actually have to start monitoring these platforms. Now, of course, the Germans are very, very mindful of this. Germany, of course, is one of those countries where it's deep to a very liberal society. People are very free. There's freedom of information. There's a huge advocacy on human rights. Very strong on that. They're one of the largest countries, or sorry, I should say they're the largest intake countries of refugees in Europe. If you see the rest of the European countries are rejecting refugees, the Germans are actually accepting them. Very liberal. So, why is such a liberal country like Germany, many would argue, imposing such a huge penalty? Some people are saying, well, you know, if you don't allow us to do this on Facebook, you're affecting our freedom of expression, our right to freedom of expression. But as we know, every right has limitations. The same way, because I'm free to say anything, I should not be able to go outside of that park and say, let's kill all the people from Saweni. And it's not right to say that. But is it legal for me to say, let's kill all the people from China. Or let's give all the people with blue eyes. The people with all the brown eyes are taking over Fiji. Well, there are too many people from Marmalibu, in Vitalibu. That's why you see Navas and many more sort of games in the theater. You see, there are certain limitations there. We have to be able to understand that. And at the moment, the discourse in Fiji, as far as social media is concerned, is a huge, skewed perspective regarding what is the right of freedom of expression. The freedom to express anything does not give you the ability to say anything like it. It is within the limitations. The freedom of movement. If I say we have freedom, we all have freedom of movement. But, just because I'm free to move around in my country of birth, does not give me the freedom to go and walk into a school compound after that. I cannot probably walk in your yard, in your house, and it's a freedom of movement. No, there's a limitation. There's a law of trespass. So you see, everything. And you could argue the two things that actually has not, those limitations. One is the right to torture. And the other one, of course, the right to life. So, I just want to put that on the table and also tell you what's happening in other countries. Germany, of course, very much concerned about it. They have a huge history about racism. They experience the Holocaust. They were sensitive about it. And they know that if you have racism unchecked, what it can lead to. They're also very concerned about fake news that can harm the economy. If, for example, we say to you that all the banks in Fiji have closed down. They're all closing down tomorrow. What will you all do? You create panic. You create havoc. Overseas investors won't want to come to Fiji. Well, put out news and say, Fiji is going bankrupt. You heard news stories, Fiji has been sold to India, been sold to China. So fake news. Should we, as patriotic Fijians, condone that type of behavior? Should we, as patriotic Fijians, your future is in this country, should you condone that? Should you even be commenting on that? Adding fuel to fire? You need to ask the questions. Ladies and gentlemen, I think the other point that I want to make again, I don't know how many of you have heard a gentleman who unfortunately died a few years ago. Personally, I think he's one of the great thinkers, modern day thinkers. He's an academic, he's also a critic of music. He taught primarily out of Columbia University, his name is Aiyaz Sayed-Khaiyum. And Aiyaz Sayed-Khaiyum actually wrote about over 40 books. One of his books is called Representations of an Intellectual. It's one of my favorite books. It's actually not a novel. It's a collection of his lectures that he gave on BBC. It's called the Reef Lectures. And in that, Aiyaz Sayed-Khaiyum actually talks about where this is the way in which intellectuals can best serve society in light of a heavily, what he calls, compromised media and of special interest groups who are protected at the cost of larger community concerns. Aiyaz Sayed-Khaiyum suggested that we need to recast the intellectual's vision to resist the lures of what he called power, money, and specialization. I first of all agree, in fact I still check on it for coming here. You can buy it on Amazon, I think it's about $20. It's a fantastic book. In fact, I've given an undertaking, I'll bring the book, that one of the copies of those books to your library. It's a great book. I urge every one of you to read. It can be a bit heavy going at times, but it's actually very, very good book. Essentially what he talks about is that if you are going to do any analysis or any criticism, or any commentary on any subject matter, you need to be as objective as possible. You yourself need to think, am I looking at this particular issue objectively or not? How much of my analysis is actually determined by already preconceived ideas? You see an ad that you run on SBC at the moment. I don't know how many have seen it. It talks about a very simple thing. That when you actually make reference to people, don't make reference to their ethnicity. How many of us now come subconsciously to do this? Hey, we know that Fijian makes it better, probably. Or the Indian person or goes on the board. But already conjures up different types of views in your mind. Different types of stereotyping in your mind. I remember a story that if I go on to some other things, I wanted to share with you. I remember a few years ago, my brother used to work for one of the radio stations, and I came on holidays. I was at the university. So I came and they were all drinking grog and afterwards. I kept waiting to sit around drinking grog outside the radio station. So just to make conversation, I said to him, I said, you know, there's a guy from Fiji, he's just been charged for murder in King's Cross. He said, you know, King's Cross is a red light district. He's just been charged for murder in King's Cross. The first question I got from this person, Indian fellow or Fijian fellow? Indian fellow or Fijian fellow? He harassed me for nearly 2 hours, and I did not give the ethnicity. I did not give the ethnicity. Because you see, when Jews are stereotypes of Jews. What I said to him, what you should be concerned about, is that he's Fijian. He's from Fiji. In those days, of course, when they said Fijian, it meant it's okay. I said, you should be concerned that he's from Fiji. Not whether I know what ethnic group is. You see, we need to be able to, when we analyze matters, when we comment on matters, we need to be able to understand our being objective about the world. What are the mindsets that we ourselves need to analyze? In a similar vein, ladies and gentlemen, I think, as I've said, the premise for it. You, of course, are the future leaders of this country. Probably, not us old people. 69.4% of the total Fijian population today is below the age of 40. If you look at the recently given statistics by the Supervisor of Elections Office, the Fijian Elections Office, I should say, over 50% of the voters are below the age of 50. The bulk of them are between 18 and 40. You are the majority. You are the minority. As I said in the public consultation also, you will be in a few years in huge leadership roles. You in a few years will determine how the economy of this country is run. If you are currently involved in practices that is actually significantly undermining the country in which you will be the leader of, in which you will seek employment in which you the parents, in which you will be the investors, in which you will be the grandparents and great-grandparents, what good are you doing to Fiji if you are currently undermining in order to reap benefits from within the future? You have to be able to understand that. You have to be able to contextualize that. It's very, very important to do that. This is why I'm very openly critical of these types. I'm openly critical of these types. Because they are extremely skewed in the way that they present news. Extremely skewed. We are a developing country. We are a post-colonial country. If you look at most countries in the world, wherever you have colonial powers, excuse me, they invested very little in infrastructure. When they left in the 1970s, bulk of the Fijian population did not have access to electricity, did not have access to water. We still have people in Fiji today that are drinking water from creeks. Far more people are now connected to water, far more people are connected to electricity. We still have a lot of those people drinking from creeks. I was just on the weekend in Panamalipo, just outside of Shanghai, huge farming area, no electricity, no water, large population. These are some of the things we take for granted. We take these things for granted. We take this mic for granted. Some of them have some solar access.
So our focus as a nation, as a country, needs to be different. Our emphasis on what is used and what should not be used is also different. Our ability to be able to report fairly and objectively what we should be reporting on is very, very critical. I want to take this opportunity, given that I'm also the Minister of the Economy, and as the Vice-Chancellor highlighted earlier on, that recently we delivered the budget. And I wanted to highlight some very common issues that I haven't talked about, and there's not much facts around it. One of them, of course, is about debt. Fiji's debt. A lot of people talk about it, and indeed make a song and dance about it, but actually don't understand. We had the Shadow Minister of the Economy missing Parliament by saying that the government has added $5.2 billion to Fiji's national debt. First, look at the truth, said in Parliament. The truth is that the current debt level of Fiji is $4.7 billion, Fijian dollars. And the truth is, out of the $4.7 billion, $2.9 billion we inherited at the end of 2006. The debt incurred by previous governments of $2.9 million. Over half of the debt that we have today in Fiji is the debt incurred by the previous governments. The truth is, the debts that we are repaying today are also the debts of the previous governments. We have to do that. We have to honor it. Because it's our country's name is safe. We cannot come as a government and say, oh no, those guys, we're not going to pay. We incurred it as a country. We have to do that. That is the fact. Indeed, those of you who do accounting and economics who know that a dollar borrowed 10 or 20 years ago is not the same as $1 today. So the $2.9 billion of debt that we inherited is equivalent to almost $4 billion in today's present value terms. We need to compare, of course, apples with apples. And again, I'm talking about the issue that I'm talking about is intellectual honesty. This is what I was driving at. Apart from the fact that you need to have an open mind, we need to have intellectual honesty. If we are going to analyze anything as a country, our politicians, whether it's opposition, whether it's government, inside, outside parliament, whether they're leaders, whether in commerce, whether in business, we need to have intellectual honesty. Let me give you another example. Some of you might know this. Fiji used to have its own bank. It used to be called the National Bank of Fiji. What actually happened to the National Bank of Fiji today, these elderly people over here would know, because of the excesses, people used to go and borrow money from the bank, because a minister would write a note in the back, literally, in the back of a paper, please give $50,000 to my cousin. Back of a paper. In order to service that bank, the SDT government then borrowed $209.1 million just to bail out NBF. Sorry, it's a very big Freudian shift. They do need bailing out. In 1996 and 1997, this money borrowed in today's prices is almost $450 million. So $450 million. Because of the mismanagement of our national bank, was spent just to bail it out. Of course, if you look at the interest rate in place earlier, it's about $200 million. As I said, many of you don't know the ratio of risk on our bank. It's gone. It's finished. Kaput. So, alas. The total cost of NBF cost us $650 million in today's terms. And today, we expect the leader of Sri Lanka, who is also the Prime Minister then, who drove the National Bank of Fiji as the alternative Prime Minister. What a ridiculous proposition. You need to think about that. Under a person's leadership, in which the National Bank of Fiji was lost, that person is now trying to regain the confidence as the Prime Minister of the country to look after your money. That, ladies and gentlemen, is the fact. Furthermore, what is actually happening now? Today, again, we have a bank that is 100% owned by the Fijian people. And that is HSC. Just started about 2-3 years ago. Very early days. It's owned by the Fiji National Provident Fund. Those of you who actually pay for PF, you are actually shareholders in it. Those of you who join the workforce, you become shareholders in it. And then you can trust the Fiji. Again, you talked about debt in the way of how much money the government is spending. As I highlighted in the budget, that today, out of the total amount of money that we make available in the budget, only 59% of that goes into paying the operating costs. Operating costs meaning the running of government on a day-to-day basis. Today I pay over by plane. The airfare comes from the operating cost. Now my staff here, her salary, my salary, is paid out of the operating cost. 41% of that money that we totally announced in the budget goes towards capital expenditure. So over 40% of the money goes into capital expenditure. Let me tell you what the issue was before. Before, the mix was 85% in operating expenditure and 15%, 12%, 13% only in capital expenditure. So most of the money that was being spent at that time was money that was spent in that year and you had nothing to show for it the following year. When you have more money allocated for building things, capital expenditure, you have something to show for it. You now have a four-lane road outside Nandi Airport going all the way up to the turn off to Denver near the new Sitar, Russia, four-lane road. As I highlighted in the budget presentation also, when you drive along the four-lane road, you don't see any overhead cables. I don't know how you notice it. There's no overhead cables, you've got overhead cables over here. How can you even find any overhead cables? Why? Because you put everything underground. So next time there's a cyclone, there's nothing to blow down. It's what you call building resilience in the infrastructure. We love to do more underground cabling throughout the region. Cost more money. But we want to do that. The water pipes. As you know, before when they built roads, they played many of the roads. I would be surprised if the road over here too. When you build a road, you put the water pipe underneath the road. When the water pipe leaks, you dig up the road to fix up the water pipe, but don't fix up the road. When the water pipe leaks, you don't know the pipe is leaking. Suddenly the ground is getting softer and everybody says, my God, this road is terrible. Too many potholes. Then eventually, maybe after 1 or 2 years, they'll find out, oh, it's a big leak. You dig it up. You've taken out all the water pipes, put it on the side of the road. All the cables on the side of the road. So next time something happens to the water pipe, something happens to the cables, you dig the spending money to do this thing. Yes, it's good to spend money to build things. Yes, we are incurring debt. But not as much as we made out. But guess what? The myth is, they are saying, oh, the young people have to pay for it. But guess what thing that you want to do? You want to have to build a four-lane road outside down the airport, it's already there. All the things that we are building and spending money to build is for the future. So your need to spend on capital infrastructure will be reduced. Therefore your need to borrow will be reduced because we are incurring the debt now to give productive capacity. A simple example that I did give is that we have many villages, many fishermen who live in areas where there's no electricity. They sell fish by the roadside, you come up to Rakhidak in all those places. They sell fish by the roadside, you catch the fish in the morning, you walk and drive past and sell the fish. Now if they don't sell the fish by the afternoon, they have a problem. If they don't have electricity, how do they store the fish? They either will have to eat it themselves, or they sell it to you at 1/10 of the price, or nobody comes along, they're sitting down and eating fish, they're probably throwing away. The moment you connect them to electricity, they're able to cool that fish. They don't have to bring down the price. Next morning, they take it out, they pull out of the freezer, throw water in, you drive by, and say, first mission set. You get a good price for it. You see, this is the power of building infrastructure. We have spent, in this year's budget, or we've been spending, over $900 million in the education sector. The university is getting around $1.3 million. All of you who will be attending university next year, or actually from 1st of August, your allowances are going to increase from about $4,000 to about $6,000. You'll be getting now paid over the holidays too, the semester breaks, trimester and the mid-semester breaks. If you realize that, of course, if you need money, you don't stop needing money in holidays, you do need money then too, right? You do need accommodation. Why are we spending this money on you? Why is the education sector getting over $900 million? Because we believe that if we educate well, we believe that if you actually have access to technology, access to qualifications, you'll be able to not just get a good job for yourself, but contribute to the country. Every country is as strong as the qualifications of people it has in that country. Today we have a shortage of marine scientists, shortage of foxes, shortage of pound planners, land surveyors, doctors, nurses, specialists. Huge shortage. In fact, we have a shortage of welders. Welders in Suba are young people to welding. They get paid $16-17 an hour. Bricklayers are getting paid $7-9 an hour. There's a huge shortage of those people. To do the tiling at Nandi Airport, we actually have to bring in tilers from Samoa to work in New Zealand because we don't have enough professional tilers. These are the kind of changes that are taking place in our economy. The point that I'm talking to you about issues such as debt, such as infrastructure, such as cost, is that for you to be able to understand, and the point is this, economic empowerment is actually the salvation of any country. You see, the old political mindset was that this group of people has something, in order for them to empower them, we should take it away from them and give it to them. It's the old way of thinking. Nobody talked about increasing the overall size of the pie so everybody can benefit from it. That is very important for us to understand. Intellectual honesty, ladies and gentlemen, also requires that we do actually talk about political issues. We talk about, more importantly, economic issues. We need to be honest in our analysis. We need to ensure that, for example, when we talk about the sugarcane industry, many people talk about the decline of the sugarcane industry. One of the fundamental causes of the decline of the sugarcane industry was the non-renewable leases, the politicization of the renewable leases, or non-renewable leases. In La Paz, the sugarcane production halved by 50% overnight. If you look at the RBA statistics, you say there's something about 22,000 cane farmers up to 1997. The moment we see what we do, it's sort of huge. Today, now we have about 10,000 registered cane farmers. My point is this, whatever happened in the past has happened. When we want to discuss what is actually happening on the state and the affairs in the sugarcane industry, we need to be honest about it. I hear many politicians on the other side of the floor in Parliament, they completely don't mention the past. They don't mention it because they may be a coalition, they may have friends on one side. My point is that when we have to discuss anything to do with the economy, we need to be able to say, yes, that's what actually happened. Because if you are honest in the analysis, you'll be able to find a better solution. I was in the last one Saturday. I had a group at the Talanoa session with a group of people. This, of course, Talanoa session, this normalized and started by the local Prime Minister. The Prime Minister, the most successful Prime Minister in Fiji's history. Before he saw the Prime Minister, he took off the other way. Now people are in the country and sit down. And in that session, a lot of the people who sat there said to me, it's staff from TELS, the staff from the Lands Department, the staff from other ministries, I should not do it twice. The talk was rudely, they don't wish to respond on time, they lose their documents. My response was, yes, we have to accept that. It is happening. I should apologize to them. No Fijian citizen should need to go through that. No citizen who has to go through the civil service, you know, needs to be treated by a rude man. Many civil servants do that. This is why I talk about civil service reforms. Opposition says just to get their votes, they say civil servants should have a job for life. Nobody has a job for life nowadays. If you go and work in the hotel industry, there will be a 3-year contract, a 5-year contract. But of course, you'll get renewed if you're doing your job well. If you have a job for life, and you treat people like garbage, do you think you're going to make any difference? Do you change your attitude? The very name itself exemplifies service, civil service, servant to the civil society, public servant, servant to the public. That's what the name implies. In fact, it's the other way around. People run after civil service. Not all of them. There's some very good civil service. But my point is this. We have to be honest. We have to recognize the problem. We today now have a helpline. 157, I think, from memory. You go to Lautoka Hospital. You have a complaint. You actually call 157 and lodge a complaint. The security guard talks to you rudely. The nurse is rudely your mother. They're not giving the injection on time. You can lodge a complaint. The proper protocol is in place for you to be able to get redress. Your actual issue won't get addressed if you post it on Facebook. And then 1,000 people comment on it. The various breaches of privacy rules. You have people take photographs of people in hospitals. Some ladies in the hospital, lying in the hospital. Newspaper people going out taking photographs of them. Did you ask for permission to be put on social media? To be presented in such a manner? Did you ask the grieving parents who were crying when the child had died for whatever reason? Did you ask the permission to put it on social media? Where's their privacy? Where's their right to privacy? Which is actually in the Constitution. So we need to be able to think about these issues for us to be able to ensure that we actually put in place a society, a country that's actually far more not just sensitive, but understanding, but also for the people. Ladies and gentlemen, I also want to mention about, I think I've got a bit about those areas. The other point that I also want to make is very important, and I've touched a little bit on it, is the issue of minimum wage. A lot of people talk about minimum wage. The minimum wage is essentially for what we call unskilled workforce. There are other types of minimum wage. There are what we call 10 sectorial areas of employment where people get paid hourly. So for example, our waiters' minimum wage is very different to what the national minimum wage is. Waiters' minimum wage is far more high. Our welder, our boilermaker, our carpenter's minimum wage is far more high. Then what the minimum wage? The national minimum wage, you have people who are unskilled workforce. Somebody who may come and cut grass at your house. Somebody in Fiji, what we call household. People who work at your house and you're cleaning in your house. That's minimum wage. There was no minimum wage until the banking round government. We started off at $2 an hour. Today, as announced in the budget, it's $2.68 an hour. But there are other areas that have far more higher wages than the minimum wage. I need you to understand that. A lot of people at the moment say minimum wage, they think it applies to all professions. It doesn't. It's only one school. We've had some political parties, because they want to get the vote of certain people, they said, we must increase the minimum wage to $5 an hour outside Parliament and said, how many of you here would pay $40 a day to the people who come and go to your house to help you clean up the house. Do the cane farmer, you know when they cut cane, the hot burning sun, in the mornings, they have somebody called a paniwala. You know what a paniwala means? The guy with the water. So runs around and gives people water. Are you going to tell the cane farmers to pay the paniwala $40 a day? They work 8 hours. The person who comes and cuts grass at your house, how many people actually pay $40 a day, or would pay $40 a day? I have a lady who was working, she said, I have two children. I have two people who are employed to look after my children. She said, I feed them, give them three meals. Breakfast, lunch, dinner. One of them says, in my house, I don't charge them accommodation. And they still want me to give $40 a day. I can't afford it. If that's the case, I will stop working and I'll stay at home and look after my own babies. You see, you have to look at the effects, what they call the inflationary impact of wages. The $2.68 was arrived at by having widespread public consultations. And after the consultations, after taking into account the fact that today education is free, the fact that today, if you earn $30,000 a year in a household, government pays 50% of the electricity cost. You tell it. This is electricity cost. It's 34 cents a unit. If your household earns less than $30,000 a year, you'll pay 17 cents for you. If you earn less than $30,000 a year, we actually now provide you free water up to 90,000 liters of water a year. So all of these things have been taken into account before arriving at the minimum wage. But as I said, not more people are being paid not more money because of the fact that there's a huge demand for the services. The other point that I'd like to make is very important to understand. There are over, conservative estimate, 130,000 Fijians today in Fiji who work for themselves. You can drive from here to Nandi, you can see people selling coconuts by their own self. People sell vegetables. Obviously, people sell vegetables. They buy vegetables from a third party or buy from a farmer, and they put a little bit of margin and they sell it by the roadside. People sell coconuts by the roadside. Some women or pets, they sell it. These people are self-employed. The minimum wage of $5 is not an effective. They never suddenly start paying themselves $5. Whatever they make, they own them. But it will adversely affect her. Because if you go to the shop over here, I know you're going to buy your ice box or whatever from you. If there's somebody working there at the shop, and if it goes up to $5, the price of your ice box is going to go up. If the shopkeeper is going to pass on the $5 cost to you, and assuming your source of income is from yourself, I still sell the coconuts at $2 a coconut or $1.50 a coconut. I make $50 a day. But suddenly everybody else around me will be charging me more money for the services I need. Because they will pass on the $5 cost to me. That's what happened. So again, we have to be able to understand that the society we live in is a society that is a mixture of people from different sectors of the economy. Over 130,000 people live in the gaining the employment or gaining the source of income from the informal sector. And the others are what we call wage employees. So this is one thing to understand that when we discuss these issues, how we are able to bring about some level of intellectual honesty to be able to address these issues. Like I said also, of course, many people are now getting paid far more than the actual minimum wage itself in the other areas. Another area that I also want to briefly discuss before I let you open the floor for any questions with the information that we see is climate change. Climate change is very, very important because we need to understand that, again, you know, there are some people, some politicians have said, oh, the Prime Minister is dealing with climate change issues. He needs to understand what is happening. He fully understands what is happening. Climate change has no borders. So I can't do not know whether it's Fiji here or so. come over here, Australia. The weather patterns are created because of the climatic changes that are taking place globally. The irony, of course, is that a country like Fiji has a negligible carbon footprint compared to other countries in the world. People in the Pacific are facing the brunt of it. Cyclone Winston killed 44 Fijians. It was the second strongest storm recorded ever in the world that hit landfall. Just digest it for a second. Nearly 6,000 kilometers of electrical cables fell during Cyclone Winston. We lost $1.4 billion of our GDP. That's why we don't like cyclones. Kills people. It costs lots of money. We are spending $170 million to rebuild schools. 95% of all the schools we are rebuilding did not even have an architectural plan, did not even have an engineering plan. Nothing whatsoever. Is it built by communities or, you know, people that have a bit of money to step something together? They're in classrooms. They did what they could. So now all those schools that are being rebuilt are actually being built with architectural plan, are being built with engineering standards. And they're all being recorded digitally. So next time the building blows away, we know exactly what blew away. We knew exactly what bolts were used. But then you have people saying, why is it taking so long? We should put it up together overnight. Yes, you can do it. We've got a slap stick job. Put some panels, paint, we put 600 million in trouble. What is good use of money? Good use of money is when you rebuild it so it doesn't actually fall down again. Good use of money is when you employ professionals to be able to ensure that the job is done properly. So ladies and gentlemen, I wanted to essentially just highlight those issues to you using the budget as the guide for that. But I hope that it does actually provoke some thought process in you to be able to understand that we live in a world where you are actually very much empowered with information, with access to technologies, your university is moving towards that. But it is a great opportunity for you to be able to use the technology to access information that people in the prior generation did not have access to. We did not have things like internet. Absolutely nothing. So please make good use of that technology. Making good use of the technology means empowering yourself, empowering the people around you, and also ensuring that by using the technology you become a little bit patriotic. We need not more patriotism in our country. As I said in the budget consultations, the next time when you're walking down the street and you're eating that packet of bean, the ice cream, whatever it is, I've seen so many thousands of times people eating a packet of bean and finished it. In the last minute, in the mountains, throw the packet on the ground. Absolutely without a care. In fact, we become subconscious about it. Just like it's thrown away. Tomorrow, the Honourable Prime Minister is of course launching the plastic levy that we put on. Why are we doing it? Next time you walk, just drive down here and see how much plastic is on the side of the road. The reason why we're actually getting you to pay for it, it won't be a good point when you go buy a vessel at the market or point of sale, wherever there's cash register. They'll ask you if you want a plastic bag, please pay me 10 cents more. We could have done it at source and done it at the factory. The reason why we're doing it when you go and want a plastic bag is to change your pattern of behavior. So, oh shit, I will pay 10 cents more. Tomorrow is being launched with all these women from Bar, actually, who are supplying these bags that they sew. So when you buy a bag that's sewn, every time you go to the shop, you carry that bag. You go to the market and carry it back. It's also generating employment. Source of income for these units. So I'm now saying that more people buy their bags. They'll hopefully get a cleaner environment. We need to be able to understand these things, ladies and gentlemen, because these small things do matter. These small things that you make your country look more attractive, and by making your country look more attractive, by having infrastructure in place, by having a level of discussion and discourse, the intellectual environment that is actually honest, you are creating one better future for yourselves. Thank you very much.